The veins?
Yeah.
The veins are, they're dependent on skeletal muscle, but not that, not the only thing. They're also dependent on the pumping of the heart, because the pumping of the heart has a pressure that even shows up in the capillaries. Even though it's very, very small pressure, or that's the hope, there's still a pressure to kind of keep stuff moving through those capillary beds. Yes, no, maybe. Everybody's with me. Okay? So, what's the function of the lymph? The lacteals, those lymph capillaries that are going to be at the small intestines. Well, at this point, when we take in our foodstuffs and any of the fats that have been taken in that have gotten broken down, we've got to take that fat, because remember, it's insoluble. We had to have some digestive enzymes come in and help to break it down, and we've got to get it to the blood circulation. One of the things that'll happen with the fat droplet, the body will form this little membrane, it's a micelle, okay, the micelles come together, and it's going to end up being called a chylomicron, but I don't want you to get that detailed with it, okay? But we've got to kind of package that fat droplet, and then we've got to take that fat droplet to where it needs to be, all right? Now, in some cases, this could be taking it to tissues, to cells, so they can use it, all right? If we take in too much, it's going to be taken into the adipose cells, all right, where it's going to get stored. But we've got to have a way to transport that fatty substance. So what these lymph capillaries can do, okay, they can help collect, wrap, and move. Well, not really wrap, but they'll help collect the wrapped portion and help move it into the bloodstream. Lymph is also good for collecting excess fluids. So if we have a buildup of fluid at that cellular space, it can actually help collect that, which can be good because that can help keep swelling, edema, fluid buildup, and so forth down at the cellular, you know, keep it down, keep it more under control. Now, when we're collecting, it can help deliver that excess fluid to the bloodstream so that we can get rid of it. Now, does that mean it could become waste? Yes. Okay? Think about going to the kidneys. Another thing that we're going to be able to do, deliver foreign particles to the lymph nodes. What do I mean by a foreign particle?
Bacteria or virus?
Bacteria, virus, parasite, something that has tried to invade the body. So when we pick this material up, okay, one of the things that those lymph capillaries are very well adapted for, okay, they're very well adapted for picking up little proteins or these little foreign particles that we really might not need to be having in the circulation. So, what we're going to see is that when we have the flow into that lymph node, hopefully, if there's something foreign, the system can take care of it. Now, is that going to always be a simple system? Not by any stretch of the imagination, but is it cool? Oh yeah. So the lymph, well, I think I kind of mentioned the skeletal muscle movement, but remember we had those two collecting ducts, and then we're gonna empty into the subclavian veins and the trunks, okay? Skeletal muscle is very important for helping move the lymph, the fluid, okay? The pressure for lymph is almost non-existent. So that's why we are dependent on the skeletal muscle movement. One of the things that we're dependent upon, because did you happen to notice a lot of these lymph nodes being located in that thoracic cavity? And we had that thoracic duct and we had some of the trunks and everything. Every time you breathe, you're helping move lymph. And you're close to what's going to be emptying into those subclavian veins. So, think about taking a deep breath, not shallow breathing like we normally do, okay? Deep breath, and the muscles that are used. And then we've got a huge muscle right here, termed the diaphragm. And the pressure, believe it or not, we haven't gotten to the respiratory system, but the actual movement up and down of that diaphragm is huge. And that's helping move some of that lymph fluid. And some of the larger lymph vessels, we'll see smooth muscle, but for the most part, we are dependent on skeletal muscle for the movement. The way that the lymph is going to flow. Now, this is giving us a view of a lymph node. Kind of cool, okay? Lymph nodes are only going to receive fluid from one direction, and they only move it in that one direction as it flows through. Now, in that lymph node, what are we trying to represent sitting in that lymph node?
The cells that have to cleanse the fluid.
So they're showing me T cells and macrophages. How did those T cells get there?
Traveling.
From where?
The blood flow. Or the gland.
What gland? They have to go to the thymus gland, be exposed to the hormone in the thymus gland, and they've traveled there from the thymus gland. Now, some of those T cells, are they going to be just new cells? Or are some of those T cells going to kind of be old and been there for a long time? Why are they old and have been there for a long time?
Stored there.
Why did they get stored there?
Disease.
Why?
Mm-mm.
I'm asking about the ones that have been there for a really long time.
The memory?
No. They're a memory cell.
Oh.
So if something that you've gotten exposed to comes by, flies right by them, they're like, oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. That's as far as you get to go. Because guess what? We've encountered this before. We're not playing this game. Y'all are too young to know about homie don't play that, right? Okay. So, I don't know if y'all know about that. All right, but I used to love, you know, was it a chicken or whatever that he had? Yeah. Anyway, okay, so T cells, Maybe they haven't become a memory cell yet. They might get incorporated to fight something. If they fight something, they'll form memory cells. Memory cells will stay there. Now, the macrophages. What do you kind of remember about macrophages?
They eat up things.
They're going to eat stuff up. And they're not going to have this really huge long lifespan. Okay? Because what they'll do is they'll fly around in the blood, okay, and they'll be fighting stuff off, all right? However, if they can't fight something off, they can act as that little antigen-presenting cell where they take a little piece of whatever has tried to invade us, okay, and they can take and now become a presenting cell to cells in the lymph node to get help. Okay, I told you it was a cool system. All right, so the flow, note that we can have several of these afferent vessels that will come into this lymph node. And as the fluid moves in, the fluid's gonna kind of do this number, and then it's gonna move out and go on its merry way. All right, so here they're giving us this view of a lymph node. And with the lymph node, what's obstructing that? There we go. So this movement becomes important because we need to push that fluid, and that fluid needs to continue moving and moving and moving and moving until we get back to that subclavian vein, okay? However, anything that can obstruct the flow affects the tissue fluid. In the case of breast cancer, women who've had breast cancer, and if they've had the mastectomy, a lot of times what they'll do is they'll remove lymph nodes, okay? One of the areas that we have a high concentration of lymph nodes is in the armpit, the axillary area, okay? Women who've had, they try to do a little, not quite as extensive as they used to, because, you know, when they first started, you know, with breast cancer and that sort of thing, removing the breast and checking the lymph nodes, in some cases, depending on the severity of the cancer, they might actually have all of their lymph nodes in this axillary area removed. So that means there's still capillaries and lymph vessels all in this arm. The tissues are still metabolically active, okay? But the lymph would kind of get stuck. And women who would have that done, by the end of the day, their arms are all swollen and blown up, edematous and everything. So they would have to roll on this really tight, constricting sleeve, so that during the night while they sleep, it would push the fluid back and try to get it into the subclavian veins. And so what happens is if people have the removal, surgical removal of lymph nodes, you obstruct the flow for that area of the body. Okay, there will be certain consequences for that. Other things can begin to affect the flow, okay? And anything that's going to cause it to build up, well, that's going to be edema. And in some cases,